I'm going to be your trainer for this course. So you guys can see my screen, right?
Yes.
Okay. So before we proceed, let me just quickly short few things. Okay. So I think today is kind of a demo class, so where generally what I do is like I just walk you through about the course content, and I take your expectation, and then we decide like how we have to proceed, and I just let you know like what all topics I'm going to complete, what will be the limitations of the course, what all OS and all I'll be using. If there is any prerequisite that you have to purchase before attending this class, so that all will short out today in just 1 hour, and then we'll see for the next class. So Bhushan, coming first to you, like could you please just let me know about your experience on VAS and like a kind of technologies you are working currently and expectation from this course, like if you are looking for something more in particular, like this topic, that topic.
Okay, so I do not have any experience with VAS. I've seen VAS. Basically, I work on a few IBM products like IBM FileNet, IBM DataCache, and VPM. And all these products are hosted on the VAS server. Okay. I'm not into developer's role. I'm not into admin's role, but I feel there is a need to understand how this works and how to configure this VAS install. It is advantage. Okay, so basically we need to apply sometimes patches on the VAS and some configuration needs to be changed. So I should be aware. The expectation from this course is get the awareness. How can install the VAS, how can install the patches, and some of the basic configuration which needs to be taken care.
Okay, great. Okay. And okay, Bhushan, you can go on mute. And it's Tejas, right?
Yeah, Teja.
Teja, sorry. So Teja, could you please just tell the same thing from your side also?
I'm basically everything is new for me. I'm not familiar with anything. I mean, I did my bachelor's in computer applications, but after that, this is the first time I'm.
So you did your bachelor last year or this year?
No. It was like 15 years back.
Oh, sorry. Okay, yeah. So this middleware part is new for you, right?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. So that are there any particular reason, Teja, that you're looking for this course? Like in respect of like if you're looking for like Bhushan told, he does some patching and configuration change. So like that, you have anything in particular in mind?
No, actually, I have no idea. Like one of my friend is working on this. Like she is a VAS admin, okay. So she was asking me to learn this. So you know, it would be easy. Like tomorrow after I get a job, if something is there, she can help me a little bit. Not much, but a little.
Okay. So understood.
That's yes. why I thought I'll do this.
Yeah, fair enough, understood. Okay, so it's good that we both are on the same page, and Bhushan and you. So the course will be quite relevant for both of you in terms of content and all. So before, go for introduction or something like that. So let me tell you something about the prerequisite.
So are you going to, I'm sorry to interrupt, but are you going to cover like all the topics like you were talking about patch and something else? Yes. So I'm going to cover everything in this?
Yes. Okay. Yes, that we'll cover today in this demo class. So before because you both are new to middleware, so I want to check like about the prerequisites. So because that will be that will be the mandatory kind of prerequisite. So you both are aware of the basic Linux, right? Basic Linux commands, like you have worked in any Unix server, like via PuTTY or something.
No, I have not worked, but I'll figure out if some of the basic command names to be learned.
Yes, because we need not to have a pure Unix knowledge, but basic things like basic file management, like directories, files, and then running some shell script, because VAS is having lots of shell scripts to do anything in VAS, like to start server, stop server, to create something, to delete something. We have a UI also, but most of the companies, they block the UI because UI based access and all, they get the headache on that. So there are many things we do from background. So VAS is running on Windows also. So in terms of OS, you can have that VAS can run on Windows, where you can go on a simple folder, and suppose here some scripts are there, and then you can just right click run as an administrator or something like that you can do. But VAS on Windows now it's not happening, because Windows gets a lot of auto patches automatically, and it goes and corrupts VAS. So in many companies, if they are on Windows, they are moving to Linux. So VAS on Linux, that we are going to cover. And for that, you have to have your setup at your end. So generally, how we cover the course is let me write everything so that it will be on your mind also. So how we cover the course is I will have a setup at my end, a blank setup where I'll have VM running at my end. So the VM that I'm using is Workstation Pro. So, and then on top of Workstation Pro, I have installed CentOS. So CentOS is an OS which gives me Linux platform. So CentOS 7 or 8, maybe it will be there. So CentOS 7. So this we have to do. So if you guys do not have that, so we can help you on that also. So the OS we can share with you. So this CentOS 7 you can simply download, because it's a 4GB file. So saving and then downloading, first I have to upload this in somewhere in the Google Drive, and then from there you have to download. So it will be in a headache. So rather than doing that, I'll give you the website. I think it's a Red Hat some website. So I'll give you that website link from where you can just go and download that OS. And then this Workstation Pro. So this installable, we can share with you. And if you need support on that, how to set up this workstation and how to do a Linux image creation on that, we can help you that also. We have a recording, a readymade recording also from the earlier batches. If that suits you, we can hand over that recording. Else, next class we can sit down. I don't know, I'm having that running at my end. So this is VMware Workstation Pro. So if you need that installable at your end also, I can uninstall this, and next class we can install in recording. You can refer that recording and do the setup at your end also. So I'll suggest to have the same version, same OS at your end also, so that there is no OS compatibility when we are doing something. So So we are not losing in time like, hey, I have something else, and when I'm trying to do this, which you did in class, I'm getting this kind of warning. So rather than I go and troubleshoot that, let's have the same kind of setup also. So this is the basic setup you need. So, and you understood like softwares will be shared or links will be given, and support will be given if you need help to set that up. Once we have that, then what we have to purchase, we have to purchase little bit of Linux knowledge. Little bit of Linux knowledge means like you have to just know like how to do file copy from one directory to another directory. You should know what is the file system and to run some scripts, like basic to tail some log, like to see the last 10 lines, first 10 lines, to like find some particular string in something. Like, anyways, those all will be covering during the class, during the labs that will be covered. And if you feel like, hey, something is new for me, this command is new for me, we can simplify that command and then we can copy that command in Notepad. We can write one line that this command will do this, and then you can keep that as a reference for you. So that will be the basic prerequisite. And if you feel challenged, we'll have all the mutual support to each other to have this thing done. Apart from that, before coming to the course material and all, and content and all, because I'm talking about prerequisites and all and the sharing and all, so other things like other softwares, like to install VAS at your end, we need lots of softwares. Like you can see, like if these many files are there. So like to install VAS, there is these three files you should know, have at your end. I'll be referring these files and install VAS at my end. So you should also have these all files. So these all are the files which you you will get. Vasu will share. So all the softwares will be shared via Google Drive, and links and all Vasu will give you, and will guide you how to download and how to use that. So during the installation class, I'll tell you, and then you have to follow the steps. So these softwares will be shared with you, setup will be shared with you, and then class notes. So class notes will be something like this. Now you can see that this recording is also, this demo is also being recorded. So if you need the post class, the recording gets converted into VLs, like normal MP3 or MP4 format. So it takes 2-3 hours, because this GoToMeeting put into some different format, and then Vasu will convert that, or someone, or me, or like based on whatever who will convert it. So they will convert into MP4 format, and then that also will be shared with you via Google Drive. So you have the softwares, you have the recordings, and the class notes are also available. So like I have prepared the class notes. So like you can see is like topic wise, like whichever topic I'll be covering, topic wise notes will be available with each and every detail. So like what you have to do. So like say we have to install something. So it says that it contains only one zip file, copy this like this, unzip this, modify this, do that, whatever. So all this will be shared with you. So like this, the course will be progressing. You have all the softwares, you have the recording. I'll do the installation in the class. Same thing you have to repeat before the next class, so that you have all the doubts ready before the next class. Similar, like meanwhile, the notes are also handy. So you go through the notes. If you have any doubt, I didn't get this part, or something. If you are doing your own more handouts, then you can ask additional doubts. And as you both are new, so that disclaimer is not valid. Where I tell people like you cannot come and ask your running projects to me. You cannot say, hey, I'm doing something in my project and that's not working, so tell me. Because that actual scenario I'm not having in front of my eye, so that will be a little tricky for me to explain and troubleshoot. So anyways, you both are new to me. I don't think like you guys will be creating those kind of situations. So if that's all good, then I'll go through this PPT. So this PPT says about the part that
Sorry to interrupt you. I have one question.
Yeah.
All of our VAS servers on the Windows environment currently. So
yes.
While explaining or demonstrating on Linux server, could you please also cover some of the Windows part, how to operate on Windows, because that would be really helpful.
Yes. And
all projects in previous project as well was installed on Windows, not on Linux.
Okay, so see, Windows versus and Linux, if you talk about, so there's no challenge like in terms of administration. Like we are going to be an OS admin, so there is no challenge in terms of administration, because in both flavors you get WAS UI, which they say WAS admin console. So where you get a UI kind of feeling, you can go and click this link, do this, something like that. And then both platforms will give you like command prompts also. Like if you're having Unix platform, then anyways you're having Unix prompt. If you are in Windows, you can always go to cmd command prompt, and then you can do the same thing manually also. So both, and only thing that changes is that there are some WAS built-in scripts. So when I say like you have to start something, then you have to, suppose you have to do something, like you have to create some dumps and all. So WAS admin scripts. So like in Windows, that will be .bat file. So that will be, and in Unix, that will be .sh file. So like in Unix, it will be a batch file. And in Windows, it will be a batch file. And in Unix, it will be a shell file, Unix shell file. And then the name will be same. Suppose the name is xyz.bat. So the same thing will be xyz.sh file. So when we'll talk about the Linux part, and when we'll be doing all the studies on admin console or the scripts part, all you have to understand is that suppose if you will be thrown on the Windows platform, all you have to understand that file system remains same, the concept remains same, console remains same. Only the thing is that the script location and all, everything will remain same. The script's extension will change and the running will be changed. So suppose in Unix you go and then you fired shell command as .slash this, something like that. In Unix you go and you have to run some command, then you'll do like invocation is like .slash in the file .sh. In Windows the file is already there, you have to just run as right click, run as administrator. Only that part changes. So I'll be taking care of that, that if there is something, if I at some point I feel like if this is something changed in Windows, then I'll do that. I'll take that in consideration. So coming to like now course content, so, and when I'll tell the content, I'll tell you the limitations also, like what all I'm going to cover, what all I'm not going to cover based on the limitations of course or limitations of the training. So like you see, when we talk about WAS administration, so I'm not sure like how much you guys know already, but you know that WAS gives you application servers, let's say. You know, like WAS name is itself Websphere Application Server. So we know that this guy is going to give me some application server. That will be virtual server. It's like it's not going to me give some, I'm not going to create some physical servers. Like my laptop is a physical server, will behave like a physical server. On top of that, I'm going to use WAS as a virtual server. So WAS will give me an application server. So when, and then obviously application server, what it's going to do, it's going to host some applications. So I will have some applications given to me by developers or someone, and then or by the build team, and then they will tell me, hey, can you deploy this application on this server? So by some means I'm going to deploy this on this WAS server. So you know that, so that's achieved. But there are many components in middleware where application works for the entire flow of or whatever for any transaction. They need connectivity to database. They need connectivity to LDAP for user management. Suppose you need user authorization, you need multiple groups, you need multiple layers of user authorization. Then you go and you go to talk to, maybe you guys heard about the TAM team, like Tivoli Access Management team or the LDAP team. Something like that. There's a team. So we'll cover this all latter part of the course. But I'm trying to take you somewhere. So like for that, I'm telling you this for now. So like WAS needs connectivity to database. It needs connectivity to LDAP for something. if there is a cross application communication, which is asynchronous, like I'm going to talk to some different application, and that application may not be alive as of now. Suppose I'm doing some payments and I need to put, suppose let's say I'm transferring fund from within, let's say I'm working for a bank, my application is a banking application, it's a mobile banking, or let's say it's an internet banking application, and I'm trying to post some payment. So the payment flow is like a payment will get it will get something like sanctioned, and then if the sanction is there, then payment will go to next layer. So from one application, request will go to another application, that application will check something, then it will route request to some other application. Finally, the request will flow somewhere where the transaction will be fulfilled. So the cross application communication will be having using messaging queue. So that will be like MQ in short. So we need MQ support. So we need WAS to talk to MQ so that when WAS is hosting this application, so this application can connect to MQ to post some message. So that so this thing, so these guys, one particularly these three guys, database, LDAP, and MQ, these are like a product as like WAS. So when we learn WAS, we do not focus learning database, learning LDAP, and learning MQ. We just focus on like, hey, how I can connect you to these three components. And to connect to these three components, what all settings we do at WAS end, being in a WAS admin. So suppose there is a connectivity between WAS and database. If this connectivity goes wrong, then being in a WAS admin, my role will be that just to go and troubleshoot that connectivity rather than going and connectivity troubleshooting that database error. So let's say I'm getting some database error. So rather than jumping on that error, hey, why this error is coming? I'll just go and check, okay, I have a connectivity between me and WAS. I'll just go and troubleshoot that connectivity. If that channel is good, I'll just raise my hand, say, hey, I have done my health checks. Everything looks good. I have checked my logs. Everything looks good. Can database team look into this error and can suggest something like that? So we do not focus more on database, more on LDAP, and more on MQ. So we do not set those things during the training class also. Like, we will just help you to install WAS, and then we'll help you to have all those connectivity learned to connect to database, to LDAP, and to MQ, but we do not have those products at our end. So actual scenario will not be covered. So I cannot show you actual connections. Hey, see, I'm from application, I'm pushing this transaction, and see that database tables are getting updated. So those things will not be done. I do not have a LDAP setup at my end, so I cannot say, hey, see, because in LDAP, this user is not authorized, so see, when I'm doing this, I'm getting access denied. Not possible. And in MQ, I cannot show you, hey, I'm sending some transaction. See, the MQ is getting this message as in its queue, and then suppose via MQ, if there's another application, I cannot say, hey, see, now this application is picking message from MQ, so the queues are empty, something like that. So now only you guys will be getting confused, hey, what is talking about queues are getting message, queues are getting empty. So we are not going to jump on all those things, because those all things are completely a different world. And when you work in middleware as an WAS admin, you have a database team, you have an LDAP team, you have an MQ team. So you do not actually look into those issues in the real environment also. You just check your WAS, your logs, then you just do your health checks, your investigation. If error lies at your end, you fix it. If it doesn't lie at your end, if it says, hey, MQ error happened, this LDAP error happened, this database error happened, this, then you just take that snippet and then post it to the particular team, and then you sit together and see what's the possible fix. So that was the limitations. So fine. So without losing time, let's go to the course content first. In the how to minimize this. Okay. So the course content is like. So the course ideally will try to cover in 20 to 25 hours, but it was up to 30 hours. So we'll try to cover course within that period. Because if you drag the course, it's like what happens, like we lose the rhythm also. Like when we are learning on every day, we are doing our labs every day, it's like it's good. Like it helps us to learn so many things in a rhythm. So first thing, like today I'm not going to cover that, but because you both are new to WAS, so I'll take you slowly towards WAS. So first we'll do all the introduction. I'll tell you about all the nomenclatures which you are going to use in WAS, like what is the enterprise application, what is application hosting, what is deployment, what is maintenance. As Bhushan told, like there's some patching happening, or there's some configuration change happening. We'll talk about all those. First, we'll talk about all those naming convention first. All those like keywords that an admin use or the middleware team use, so that we are aware of all those things before jumping to the actual WAS life. So what is WAS? A recap to client-server architect, a recap to what is server, what is application server, and what is web server. So we'll talk about all those things. I have a very good notes on that. So all the notes, like whatever I'm having, so it's nothing that will not share. Everything that we can share with you. So there's a document that I prepared long back. So like for everything, I have one liner, two liner also. So when you say like you want to switch your job, then that may help you as a like kind of interview preparation also. So everything we'll share as the course progresses. So we'll talk about all those things. And then we'll talk about in WAS, there are lots of packages. When we say like we install WAS, so WAS is a product. So when you install some product, obviously there is some version, there is some packaging. We'll talk about all those packaging, like what package we are going to use. So that WAS package that I'm going to use is WAS-ND, so which is widely used in industry. And then the version that I'm going to show you guys is 8.5. So 8.5 we are going to learn. So that's so WAS 9 is also there in my market. So WAS 9 I do not have. So 8.5 is the latest, not latest, but it's the latest that industry has been using. So though WAS has launched 9, so like you will not see 9 in most of the companies. They are still working on 8.5 because 8.5 itself launched 2-3 years back only. So sudden migration nobody does. It takes at least years before they jump into version. So as you can see, we'll do some version comparison also. Like 6, 6.1, 7, 8, 8.5, there are lots of versions of WAS available. So when you go to interview also, they ask you like, hey, what all the versions have you worked? If you have worked on multiple versions, then they will ask you, hey, can you just tell me the comparisons between these versions in terms of administration, like what all new you got into higher version. So we'll talk about all that, and then we'll talk about WAS architect. So though these things are quite theoretical, but we will study those, because if you know the theory part, if you know the WAS architect, it will help me during the troubleshooting. If you know like, hey, how WAS is set up, how its component flow is there. So when you do some troubleshooting, you know, hey, okay, the message, the message is coming till this point. Okay, then it should go to that point, because architect so says so. Then you'll go and check that component, then you'll check the next component. So you'll check like a pipeline kind of thing. So when there is a when you say there is a blockage in the drainage or somewhere, then rather than jumping, hey, why water is not flowing, if you check all the connecting points, and then if you clean all the component connecting points, obviously the blockage will be gone. So for that you should know the architect. And then there are multiple concepts, like when we'll talk about web servers, then which web server, IHS or IIS. So all those things we'll cover. But to cover that, before that, we need to have all those conventional names, like what is IHS, what is IIS, what is web server first thing, messaging, security. There's something called SSL. So all that thing we'll cover. And then we'll do the installation part. We have the software shared. Now we know what is WAS. Now we know how the flow. We know what is application hosting. We know being admin, what all I have to do. Then we'll start doing that part. So we will have the installation done. So So installation, like you can see that to do installation, we have some installation manager given into IBM package itself. So you have to understand what is installation manager. Then we'll install VAS. So VAS, I'm not going to do much deep dive today because you both are new, so it's not going to help you. I'll just tell you like what all things will cover. So installation will be covered. So like in installation, there are three layers. First, you have to install the product. Then you have to apply the fix pack. And then you have to apply additional Java. Like if you, so by default, VAS will come with Java 6. So if you want to have Java 7 or Java 8 on top of that, you can do that also. So that's multiple Java support has started from 8.0 onwards. So if I'll tell you now only what is installation and then what is fix and then what is additional Java, so it will be quite early for you guys. Rather than first I have to take you like baby steps, first thing first kind of thing. So all those, as of now, we'll just say, okay, there are three layers in installation of VAS. So we are going to cover all that. So installation and applying fix pack will be covered. So there, what all thing will cover? When you say I have to install something, then maybe in your career, you get something like, hey, this project is gone. This project is completed. Can you decommission this server? So when you say decommission, then you have to uninstall everything. So rather, so not only installation is that you have to learn, you have to learn how to do uninstallation also. So installation, applying fix pack, rollbacking the fix pack, and then uninstallation the product. So all that I'll cover in with theory, with lab, and with whatever command, suppose I have to give you, or the UI flow I have to give you, notes I have to give you, everything will be covered. It will be good if you guys also do the same thing at your end also. So like we'll cover all that scenario. And after that, there's something called profile management in VAS. Like again, this like what is profile and what is profile management will be like kind of tricky as of now to tell you guys. So there is something like when you have some product, you have all the binaries like dumped into some file system where you install that product. Now what you have to do with your binary? Now you have to create small chunks. Okay, now I have the software installed. Now I want to customize this software to behave like this. All those customization we do during the profile management. So that I'll take in the next class or the maybe 2-3 class later only, because before that we have to complete installation. So VAS profile management will do. So there are multiple profiles that we have to create. So and that will do using the command line. There are many commands to do that. So if I show you just an FYY. So there's some pictorial representation of also all those profiles. So I'll tell you when we'll jump to that part. So suppose I have to create some profile, then there will be some command that we have to fire, something like this. So I have to manage profile.sh, create profile. Profile's name is like something like DMGR01 or something like that. So before that, we have to know so many things. What is DMGR? What is template? And then profile, what is profile path? Cell, what is cell profile? What is node profile? So before jumping to that, we have to know so many things. So that we'll cover slowly, and then we'll jump to the script. We'll talk about all these scripts arguments, and then we'll fire this script and we'll see what happens. So the profile management will be covered in short. So during profile management, we'll have all the profiles created for us. And then that will be something like we have VAS and we have the software file system, and then we have customized our software for our use. And then before jumping to the next thing, so how the flow happens in middleware. So let's say you are a user. So you are a user, and then you have some application URL. You hit that URL and you expect that some page should come to me. So how actually the request goes, and let's say this is a production app URL. So how actually request flows? So request first goes to some load balancer. So load balancer, so suppose let's say you hit, let's say my URL is like https. let's say mbank dot let's say mark.com, something like that, and then I say like mbank login, something like let's say this is my URL. So I am trying to hit some login page, let's say. So I'm not going to much deep dive today about this URL. Like in later class, I'll tell you about this URL also. So the part of this URL, like I have a protocol, then S means like I have a secure protocol, then this is the host name, and then the port number is hidden. By default, the port number will be something like this 443 because it's a web server URL. So we'll talk about all those things. And then this part is called as a context route in terms of WAS. We tell it context route. So this decides, okay, on this host, which resource I'm going to search. So we'll talk about all the components about this URL, because so many times based on the URL also we do lots of troubleshooting, lots of identification. So we will talk later in more deep. So as of now, let's say I have a URL and I will just want to show you the flow, because the next part was web server. So before I introduce you to the web server, I just wanted to show you why we have web server. So when you'll say, hey, I'm learning Websphere Application Server, then why web server comes into picture during the class? So when you hit a URL, you first hit the load balancer, because I do not know how much load will be coming to me. So suppose I'm having a hotel, and in a hotel there is a reception, and then there is a waiting area, then there is a person who manages the guests, okay, which table you have reserved, if not reserved, then which table will be available for you. And then inside that there is a dining area where all the tables are there and the waiters are there. Let's say you do not have the reception, you do not have any staff at the reception to manage the reservations, then what will happen? The chaos will happen. Suppose it's a New Year Eve, everybody wants to come into your restaurant, so everybody will start coming and start sitting on the dining area randomly, irrespective of thinking that if they are ready to serve us or not, whether they are the whole load will come inside. So to handle that load, you have a diner or you have someone sitting at the gate who checks the reservation, and then based on the reservation he says okay, you have to go to that particular table. If reservation is not there, then he says okay, please hold for some time, there is a wait time for you. After that wait time, we'll serve you. If that wait time is more than your wait time, then some timeouts happens, and then you go to some other restaurant, then you go to some other server or something like that. So load balancer does that. Load balancer takes the load and it balances the load. And then back behind, who is my staff at reception? That is web server. So web server says, okay, I'm not going to serve you. I do not have that logic. Business logic at my end. I am here to just have an extra layer between you and the dining area. I'm just going to divert you to the particular dining area. Suppose there are five dining areas, then I'll tell you, okay, you have to go to dining area 2, table number 7, something like that. So that is my web server. And then web server says, okay, go back to application server. And then application server says, okay, based on your demand, I can connect to database, I can connect to NQ, I can connect to LDAP, something like that. Or maybe I can connect to outbound to some other app also. Let's say so many restaurants says, okay, we do not serve ice creams, but if you need, I can just borrow it from the nearby restaurant, something like that. So I can have connectivity to some different application also. So WAS is here. So this is my WAS. So when we talk about WAS, then we talk about this also, because this also comes to WAS admin one, because web server connects to application server. So this web server that we are going to cover is IHS, so IBM HTTP server. So we have all the IBM products, so we have IBM HTTP server. And then this web server connects to WAS via some plugins. So that we say WAS plugins. So we have to set these three things up. Load balancer, we do not set. not in training, not in real life also. Load balancer is completely a different team. Load balancer is also a product. Like they are like one of the products is like edge load balancer, application load balancer. There are so many things. So F5 is a company who handles those all load balancing things. So in your company also there will be a networking team, the internet security team, like there are some different names of the team in different organization. So they handle the load balancing thing. So when you say like, then you'll say, hey, what if your user complains that URL is not working for him, then should I check or should I load balancer team check? Then what you do, you go and check your web server logs, whether you are getting hits. If you're getting hit, it means hit is coming from load balancer. If your web server is getting nothing, it means like nobody sending the request. So who is the nobody between you, URL and me, the load balancer? Then you loop your load balancer team and says, hey, can you check if all the channels, all the junctions are up at your end? If yes, then can you just see if you're routing traffic to these IPs, because I cannot see any request at my end. And then they do something, hey, something is wrong in the mapping. We have done some changes. Can you check now? So now let's say the testing team checks the URL. You get the hits at your end, and then you check the next one. So this setup we have to do. We have to install WAS first thing. Then we have to install IHS. We have to install plugin, and then we have to connect all these things. So to connect all those things, there will be configurations. So many configurations that we have to see. Once IHS is connected to plugin is connected to WAS, then we are ready to deploy some application here. So in course, so that this is the actual flow in the real life, like the URL, then load balancer, then WAS in as a family, like where a web server plugin and application server is there, and then the outbound calls, outbound to DB, to MQ, to LDAP, to app, some other app. So we are not going to, I told you guys, these things are having limitations, because these things need, you have to have some different component knowledge also. So we are not going to cover this. This will not cover because it's another product itself. So we are going to talk up to this one. And we'll just see how request comes and how to troubleshoot if a request is not coming to load balancer. And from here, we'll talk about all the outbound configuration. How to have DB connectivity, MQ connectivity, LDAP connectivity, or SSL and all. So before coming to that, why I talk this much? Because the next topic will be insertion of web server and plugins. So unless until you know why I'm doing this, it will be irrelevant just by learning, he did this after this, so I have to learn this. You have to understand why he is doing this. So before I go and teach you the configuration, I must have the setup first. So that, for the sake of that, I'm going to install WAS, I'm going to apply patches, I have to go upgrade my Java, then I'll install IHS, then I'll install plugin, then I'll connect all these things, then I'll deploy one of the sample application for you, then I'll say, hey, the setup is ready, now explore this setup in terms of configuration. So that we will do. So suppose installation is done, and then clustering means WAS is installed, profile management is done, but after that you have to have running app servers. App server 01, 02, 03, 04, like that, 4 app servers, 5 app servers. So to do that, we have a concept of clustering at WAS. So we'll talk about clusters, and when you create clusters, you get your app servers. So we'll do that. Then the next topic will be the configuration files and the logs so far. So like till this class, you would have done installation and profile management and then connectivity of WAS to IHS and plugin. So to do that all, you need lots of configuration. So before jumping to the next topic, we'll talk about all those configuration files, all the logs file to check if everything is good till now. And then we'll do the application deployment. We have some setup done, then we'll deploy one application and we'll see if that application flow is working. If the request is going to IHS, to plugin, to app server, we'll see the logs are getting updated or not. To just test our setup. And then we'll talk about data source. Data source is nothing but from connectivity from WAS to DB. So I'm not going to cover the practicals much, but we should know the theory also. How I connect to DB, like what all the configurations are there. So that is called data source in WAS. So we'll talk about data source. Here I have written that also, that more practicals are possible. So data sources are there. And then whatever I'll talk, all the nodes will be here. So suppose if I go, where's my control? Data sources are here. So you can see data source, so steps to create a data source in selected scope. So we create some configuration RN. So step by steps are there. You can see like in the admin console, click JDBC provider, click new, and then enter this, enter that. So everything will be given to you. And there are so many timeouts at database. Suppose you're trying to connect to database, then there are so many configurations, so many parameters that you have to understand. So they say it connection pool parameters. So we'll cover all those. So the next topic, post data source. So like in two or three hours class, we'll cover data source. And then the connectivity to MQ. So to connectivity to MQ will be Java messaging services. So that is called JMS at WAS end. So we'll talk about the JMS. Then the global security comes. Global security is LDAP. So this part, so this is LDAP. So we'll talk about the global security here also. So there are no practicals possible. And then I'll tell you the global security, there are 3-4 methods. Like active, I can use Active Directory. I can use local OS. There are so many things. But to do that also, there will be so many limitations. So I have written something that lab using security wizard through federated repository method. So this will be relevant of person who knows a little bit of WAS. Like then, because they ask, hey, like if you're going to cover global security, which method you are going to use? Then I say, hey, because of the limitations, out of N methods, I'm going to cover using this method. Because you both are new, so you do not know the other methods. So I'll tell you the other methods, and then I'll say why I'm not going to cover other and why I'm going to use this method one. So this is will be the your global security. And then there is something called SSL, which is a burning topic in WAS, which you need to have to go to at least to any banking company. So banking, suppose if you are going to some other sector, maybe if they do not have much of applications invoked to internet, maybe they have all the intranet applications also, so they may work on HTTP URL also. But if you are going to some industry where particularly in banking sector, then SSL is must. So SSL I'll be covering, and SSL I'll cover. So you can see also like 19, 20, 21 slide, three, four hours will be given on to SSL only. So SSL as of now, I have written the practical only with IKML, but end-to-end lab will be done. So here I say that end-to-end lab will be done. So SSL, there are so many things, small chunks. Before coming to WAS, SSL in itself is so many theory and so many practicals. Okay, how to create this, how to create that, and then use that in WAS. So before coming to WAS, you have lots of stories. So we'll cover all that, but again, there are many methods in SSL also, that whether you use UI mode, like I am using IKMen, so like that, there are so many other utilities also, like GSK7, CMD, there is a command utility, then key store is key tool, there is another utility. So there are multiple utilities, but we cannot cover all the utilities because every utility will have some different command, different steps, and then different setup demand at a practical or like on this course. So we'll cover something IKMen, because IKMen gives me UI feel. So I'm firing some command and say, hey, let's wait for this command execution. Then I'll say, hey, something happened. So rather than doing that, IKMen gives me the UI feeling. So I can tell you each and everything. You can feel it. You can see and feel it. Okay, he's doing this. And now he's saying that something happened. So I can show you, see, in this UI. Now see, before that this key store was having nothing. Now I have imported something, and now the key store is having my certificate, something like that. So as what is SSL, why we need SSL, what is the funda of SSL, and then you can see like how to create store, how to, there are so many how to's things. So we'll cover all those things in theory, the requisites, key, why I'm doing this, and then we'll do the labs. All this will be covered. So that finishes the course, kind of. Like you have done the installation, you have done the profile management, then you did the IHS and the plugin connectivity, then you did the like clustering. So by clustering, you got the app servers, you did the deployment, application deployment, and then you did applications, database connectivity, MQ connectivity, LDAP connectivity. Then you secured your all thing using SSL. So that all we do in WAS. And then there are multiple important files in WAS. So like so I told you there are so many .sh files that you should know. So we'll cover all those files. So if you see the notes, so what I have done in notes also. So I'm not sure where I kept this. Up or down? It's up. So you can see like there are so many files. So like version info, there are so many SL, .sh files. So what all SH files you may use in your life during WAS admin journey? So like I have just listed all those. So let's say I have listed almost 33 .sh files, and then I have given one liner explanation also. So whatever files we are going to use in lab, so that will be anyways you will remember, and whatever is like you may use in life. Maybe your developer, your testing team, or someone may ask you, or your interviewer may ask you. So the file with its one-liner explanation is there in notes also. So during the class also, after all this coverage, we'll come to that part also where we'll talk about the important files, how to use that file, in which scenario you have to use this file. Suppose you are doing some let's say troubleshooting, and you want to cross-check some configuration, then which file should you go and check that configuration? So that all we'll cover. And then there is a platform in WAS for automation. It's like WAS says, okay, till now whatever I did using manual method, like I'm going to do something. And then suppose they say, okay, can you automate everything? Like suppose cluster creation, application deployment, data source creation, stop start of some app server. So all that we can do automation also. WAS says, I'm having some, they say like I'm having some framework, so they say BSF framework. So that all that deep will go during the class only. So there's something called Beam, a structured framework. So what is Beams, we'll talk about later. Now it's irrelevant, we're talking about all those things. So that in short, there's a BSF framework given into WAS, but that framework is called WSAdmin. And WSAdmin gives me some Jython scripting platform where I have multiple objects, like in Java, it has admin control, config. So for doing all those stop start part, you have admin control object. For doing all the configuration, you have admin config. To do all your application deployment management, you have admin app. And to do any bulk of thing, so you can have some task also. Okay, let me create this task. This task will go and run this, multiple layers of scripts. And in order to have help on all those things, you have an help object also. So there are five objects. Every object will have multiple methods. Every method will have multiple parameters. So again, WSAdmin, I have a big disclaimer that I'm not going to cover this WSAdmin, and because it's a basic course where we just say, WSAdmin platform is there, and then I'll tell you about the objects, I'll tell you about the methods, I'll fire few scripts in front of you, I'll do something, and then I'll say, now manually doing this is taking this much time. I can simply take this into script method, and I can fire this command, I can switch my screen, do something else, rather than being on this screen, clicking next. So that will save me some man hours. Again, so why I say is like this will be off course, a little bit. Like I'll tell you up to 30-40%. Remaining will be of course, because that needs a prerequisite that you know at least some kind of scripting automation. Because I'm not you know some logic and you have at least some cell script knowledge. So if that is not having, then telling WSADMIN script and doing all those automation will be quite tricky for you also, tricky for me also. So that will see how much we are going to digest during this topic or coverage, and then we'll move ahead. But have that in have that thing now only in your mind, because in later so many people say, hey, you told that WSADMIN scripting will be covered. Now I need this script because I'm using this thing in my company. If you'll give me this script, that will help me in my company. So that, because to avoid all those scenarios in future, so let's say after 1 month or something, let's have that setup in mind also. Now only that scripting platform is there. I'm going to tell you how to use this scripting platform. And the thing is that there's something called command assistance in WAS. So this command assistance will give you the ready-made script. So, but to use ready-made script also, you should know how to invoke this script. And how to invoke this script in terms of your company's customization. So to do that all, you should have at least any scripting knowledge. Let's say, that's why I say that good knowledge of any one scripting language is required for this. If you have that, then you will cover this. Then I can deep dive. If you do not have that, then you have to take this as a thinking, okay, there's something at WAS which will give me automation. So if I explore that, I can do some value addition in my project. So you can take my course as a base of 30-40%. Then you can go do your hard work, and then you can propose some automation at your end. And then finally, at the end of the topic, we'll talk about some new advantage that we studied in WAS 8.5, which will help you to propose this. Suppose your industry is using WAS 7 or 6, then you can go and propose, hey, I have knowledge on 8.5. I have justifications. 8.5 can give me tremendous help on administration and to do your application hosting in a better way. Then you can have your case presented to your client, and then you can have a migration project at your end. Okay, fine, we are ready to migrate all my projects from lower version to higher version. So we'll talk about, after all my knowledge, we'll talk about all those things. So logically, what I told, what all will be covered? Installation of product. When I say product, so it will be WAS, web server and plugin. And after that, connectivity on all, that will say like that is in installation only. Then will the profile management will be covered. And after that, clustering. So clustering will give me app servers. And then web server management. So web server management will give me web servers, running web servers. And then we'll do deployment. So application deployment. Deployment is also a very big topic. So there are many things in deployment. There are 3-4 methods to do the deployment. You can go, you can do deployment via console. You can do deployment using WSADMIN script. And you can do hot deployment also. You can simply dump file your package into some directory. WAS will sense it. Okay, the new package came. WAS will auto deploy that. So it looks one line, one topic, but it has so many things. When we talk about the course, we'll do all the deep dive. And once the deployment is done, then we'll talk about data source for database connectivity. We'll talk about JMS for MPU connectivity. We'll talk about global security for LDAP. We'll talk about SSL. And then we'll talk about all the config files. We'll talk about all the scripts that I may use, built-in scripts. We'll talk about all the logs. When we talk about logs, there's something called dumps. Like, I don't know how much you guys know about dumps. So there's something called dumps, and there's something called garbage collection, GC policy. So this is a burning topic in performance testing. During the performance testing, we get lots of headache at WAS. The application is not working properly. Then we have to go and tune it, and then for your interview purpose also. And then after this, we will talk about WSADMIN. And then maybe we'll talk about anything which lagged among this, and maybe if something new that you want to learn, if we'll see that if course duration permits will cover that also. So that will be your course flow. And maybe you guys understood, like doing all this course flow, every day's session recording will be shared with you, notes will be like I can share this notes in advance also, or else during the course only I'll like suppose when I take class of each class based on the class audience, I update this notes. Okay, this guy needs this input also. Fine. If someone is already having the knowledge and VAS, they need the advanced course, then what we do? Okay, he already knows this, so let me remove this from notes, and he knows he wants this, so let me add this. So the notes gets updated based on the audience. So if you want, I can share in advance. If you feel comfortable that during course you just update and then share, you will do that also. All the product binaries will be shared with you. And during class notes, you have to make your own notes. Like if you say, apart from this notes, also during class you told this, so can you just write this in words and give me? No, no, not possible. So because recording will be always with you. If you want that, and then you can just go through the recording and you can make your own notes. A global notes I'll be anyway sharing with you. During class, suppose let's say Bhushan asks something, and during the explanation of that, I gave some metaphor or I gave some additional theory, additional lab. So that will be anyways captured in the this recording. You can just go and use that and make your own notes. So that will be the way that we are going to cover this. And the OS part, I already told you that you need a workstation pro with CentOS 7 for Linux support. So we'll have that. So during so let's say like how we are going to progress from next class. How will I go? Like I'll have a blank setup. On that blank setup, we'll start covering the theory. We'll start covering the labs. Now it's open to both of you, Bhushan and Teja. So does this fulfill your expectation? Something that you want to add or any feedback?
I was going to ask you, like, when you say Linux command commands, from where do you have like a website or something from where we can learn?
No, don't do that much effort. Anyways, I told you whatever commands I'm going to fire, if you guys are not aware of that, I'll explain that command. And whatever command I'm going to fire, I'll take that command out in Notepad. I'll share that command with you. Now, then suppose let's say I fired some let's say tail command, so tail minus f some, so let's say, let me write tail minus f system out dot log. So what this command does, it's tail the log. Tail means like from bottom it's going to tail this, there's a log file, so it's from bottom it's going to open this file. And minus f means real life. So if I have opened this file and in real life new lines are getting added, so that new lines will be visible to me. So that we do during any traffic monitor, like we just tell key, okay, now I have tailed the log, and I'll ask user to hit the URL, and I'll just see key if user hits are coming. If coming, then my log will get updated. So suppose, take this as an example. Suppose this kind of command I'm going to fire. Anyways, I'm going to explain why I'm running this command. I'll take this command out in Notepad, and then you focus, okay, tail command does this. So can I just go and learn more about tail command from Google? So then simple, just fire something like it will just give you just one liner, two liner. You do not need much about any Unix commands.
And so, today your voice was not very clear. Like I can hear more like a double voice, so it's not very clear. I'm just trying. I'm putting all effort to hear it properly. I don't know if it's something is wrong in my end with my speakers.
Bhushan, is the case same with you?
There is a little bit different disturbance over your voice, but it is audible properly.
Okay.
Maybe tomorrow I'll try headphones and see. Maybe, I don't know, it could be with my computer.
Yeah, Teja, let's do that. So okay. That now.
Yeah, so I wanted to add a few points. Will you be able to cover troubleshooting of WAS server? Like if WAS is down, then what to do, what steps needs to be done to get it up? And then the performance improvement of the WAS, because this is, as you said, this is a burning topic in our organization as well. A lot of we face issues in performance improvement. Not we know knowing what are the things we can do in WAS to improve the performance. So that, if you could cover, that would be beneficial.
Yes, we'll do that. But what you say, like the flow will be different. Like suppose, like in your environment, you have the setup, and then you have a real exposure of your application to users, and then like random issues are coming, and then you are fixing that. In our case, we cannot have that setup. That we cannot have all the setup, and then we do some random testing. Okay, let me fire this negative testing and then create some issue, and then we'll troubleshoot that issue in front of you. We cannot have that kind of issue. So what we'll do during our installation, during our configuration, during our connection of some, like when I connect to WAS to web server to plugin, during that I'll tell you, hey, mark this thing. If you'll make mistake here, then this kind of error will come. And during our all those other parts, like you told about performance testing. So when I'll cover about dumps and GC policies, then they are, when I cover clustering, there is something called app server tuning. So where we talk about JVM arguments, custom properties and all. So when I talk about configuration, setup and all, during that only I'll tell you, hey, this configuration makes like is has its role like this. So if you make mistake here, it will create an issue there. So that way I'll be like kind of reverse troubleshooting I'll be giving you. So if you know that configuration, and if you feel like that issue came, then maybe you can think of because of this thing, because of this configuration, this error came. Does that answer your query?
Not clearly, but I got your point. So at least you can give some pointers where we can do, or where we can go for the tuning for the, to improve the performance.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Fine, Hussein and Teja. So that I wanted to cover today. So like, if that satisfies you with your expectation, so let's I'm not sure like how much progress we have made in terms of registration, or I don't know. So because I was told this is a demo class, so let's see if that suits you. We'll have a WhatsApp group created for us between you, me, Teja and Vasu, and then we'll have this all thing done. Like we'll have that class timings decided.
Okay, so is this a weekend batch or a daily batch, weekday batch?
I am free on weekdays morning 7 to 8. So you both are in IST region or?
Sorry? Yeah, I'm from Mumbai.
Okay.
I'm in New Jersey, so I think it's like if it's 7 o'clock there, then it's 8:30 here.
So morning 7 to 8, my timing is okay for you, right? On weekdays.
Yeah, that's fine. And are you going to take classes even during the weekend?
That I have to check, and I'll let you know. If I have to take, then maybe we'll take from next weekends.
Okay.
And then maybe we can start from Monday itself for like this course. For Monday we'll start before Monday. I'll have Vasu to share all the like these installables with you, so that and then on Monday we can cover that setup part. So like I didn't get that part. Like you guys can do this workstation pro with CentOS setup at your end, or you need support on that also?
I'm not sure. And can I do it on Mac?
Mac will be a like a big headache. Mac will be a big headache because all these I have seen old users, Mac users, they have to do lots of tuning at Mac to use these binaries also. So you don't have any Windows laptop?
Actually, I have a laptop, but it's not working properly. I just logged in today and I saw that it's not working properly. So that's why I'm on my Mac today.
These binaries, WAS setup will work, but works like Linux setup at Mac, I think that then you have to take on your own, because I don't have knowledge on that, because I never worked on Mac OS.
Okay. I'll talk to someone and see if they can.
So this I have VMware work player. Let me check which one I have. 15. Will that work? VMware work 15 player.
So it may work. So you have anything running that VM that you want to preserve?
I have 2-3 VMs for the IBM product installations, but I don't know whether this player can support the Linux as well.
Yeah, to avoid those kind of confusion only, I say like students to have whatever setup I'm having at mind. So rather than learning about WAS, we should not waste time on learning all the other OS part of. So let's have, if you do not want to lose any, if you feel like you can have your new VM set up, then let's set up this VM extension pro with CentOS one.
I have the updated version of this one.
Sorry?
I have the updated version of this VM.
Fine, okay, so that will work.
Yeah.
That will work, no problem. So fine, guys. So I think if you are good, we can wrap up. And you understood the flow, like how we are going to cover the course and how the course materials, recordings, and all will be shared with you. So let's have a WhatsApp group created, and we can meet on Monday. We can start doing this setup.
Like when you say setup, you're going to help us, right? Like with the support, if I want, I mean, you.
No, support on WAS setup. Suppose yeah. You're having a Linux setup on Mac, that will be like something which I will be not much helpful out with.
Yeah, actually, Mac, I'll try to figure that out because.
Apart from that, if you are doing something class lab, and during class lab you are facing some issue, yes, you can come to next class, or on you can take a screenshot and you can post on WhatsApp group, hey, when I'm doing this, I'm getting this error. So suppose we are not in class, we are in off hours, we are doing our office. During that, if I feel like I can answer that, I'll post that answer straight away.
No, I'm thinking about this and how to fix this. So, yeah, I'll try to get my laptop fixed. Or I'll do something.
Fine, and I'll check which my old candidate was having Mac. If that, I'll just see if you are having some issue which he faced. Then maybe I can loop you both guys over WhatsApp, or I can ask him to answer, then I can answer you.
Okay. Thank you.
Fine. So any other feedback, questions?
Nothing from mine.
Yeah, nothing from mine too. I mean, frankly, I couldn't understand properly because, you know, while I'm talking to you now, it's not that blur, but I couldn't hear properly before. So maybe from the next class, I'll just check my phones and
okay. Yeah, Teja, and I'll request you, like, if any glitches happens, and then if you could have told me in the beginning, I could have fixed it.
No, actually, that's no problem. I mean, it was okay. I'll just go through the recording one more time to make sure that's it. It's okay. Fine. I mean, I could hear you, definitely.
Fine. Fine. And there's no hesitation. If you want any repetition of, like, fine, today anyways was not any topic covered, but the next class onwards, if I cover something, which you, maybe during class you hesitated, you didn't ask, and then maybe later you find, ki, hey, this is important, I could have asked, then you can always come back and ask. So suppose if the course duration permits, ki, hey, like this was a very tiny topic, you could have, you can go and see the notes, you can go and see the recording, I can tell you. And if say, if it's something like I can feel, ki, hey, maybe I didn't explain it well, then I'll always re-explain it. So it's course for you guys. It's nothing like I have to just walk you through and you have to be a silent audience. You can always interrupt. You can always say, ki, no, I didn't understand. Tell me this one more time. Labs, you can always hold, ki, hey, I didn't get time during, suppose something was happening at my office. I have not covered my labs. So can you postpone tomorrow's class? We can discuss on WhatsApp. If both are ready, we can always do that. One thing is that suppose Bhushan is coming to class, let's say in a hypothesis example, Bhushan is coming to class and Teja didn't inform and didn't come to class. I'll just post one or two chasers on WhatsApp, ki, hey Teja, like I'm going to start class in next 5 minutes. Suppose I didn't get any response, so class will be like as usual, class will be happening and with only Bhushan, and next class like expectation will be, because Teja didn't inform well in advance, so she has to go to the recording first and then she can ask the doubts. Because and if someone informs me well in advance, ki, hey, today there is some release at my office and I'm getting late, then I'll ask the other guy, ki, hey, he is not joining today, is it fine for you to postpone today's class? Then if says yes, then the class will be postponed, the next class you both can join together. So all I am expecting, if you are joining, it's good. If you are not joining, just inform me in advance so that you are not losing your class. Like because if you didn't inform the class, because luckily we are having only two audience now. In so many classes, I have six, seven audience. So it's like for one or two audience, we cannot ask others to hold on. Getting my point, right?
Yeah.
Just if you're not joining, just let me know in advance. Like one or 2 hour window is also enough. And if I am not joining, I'll also let you guys know. Like, sir, today I'm stuck, so that you guys can plan your day. And on weekends, we'll try to, suppose I'm taking class on weekends, we'll try to cover weekends at least 2-3 hours. So make that also in mind. If we are sitting together on weekend, we'll sit for a longer period. So that will help us, because so many labs are there where a 1 hour window will not be enough. So suppose that lab, end-to-end lab in one class only will do, that will be helpful. Suppose I do one lab today and then break next class, suppose you may forget the yesterday's class. So those kind of labs I'll take over weekends, where I'll ask you guys to sit down for longer period. So we'll discuss all that well in advance so that you can plan your days.
Oh.
Fine then, so like I think if we are done, we can wrap up this demo. Then I'll just talk to Vasu and have one WhatsApp group created.
Yeah. Hey, wow, I forgot your name. Can you please?
My name is yeah. Saurabh.
Saurabh. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Saurabh.
No, sir. Fine. So
thank you.
I'll. Yeah. Thanks, Teja. Thanks, Bhushan. I'll end this meeting now.
Yeah. So we'll meet.
Yeah. When go ahead.
Is it on Monday?
Yeah. Is it on Monday?
Okay. On same timings, right?
Same timing, 7 to 8.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a nice weekend. See you guys on Monday.
Yeah.